My name is Maheshwar. I'm coming from Bombay, and I'm a professor in Anglo-Eastern Maritime Academy. I sailed on ships from 1980 to 96, that's about 16 years. Then for the last 19 years, I've been ashore, and for the last 15 years, I've been teaching. And I teach naval architecture and other marine engineering subjects and we help mechanical engineers to become marine engineers. In India, we have a one-year course where the mechanical engineers, B.Tech mechanical engineers, they can switch over to marine industry. That's what I teach about. Now, how many of us have seen, or nobody would have worked in Titanic, but everybody would have seen Titanic cinema movie. Have you? Yes. And we have you heard about Derbyshire? Yes. Herald of Free Enterprise? Yes. And Costa Concordia? Yes, we all have. See, all these are the disasters which have lots of lessons to teach us. I rate MAERSK also in that category. It has lots of lessons to teach us. And today we'll just briefly go over the lessons that it is ready to teach us. And when we talk about MAERSK, the presentation that I made is a little long enough because there's so much of technical stuff is involved in that. It's a lot of verbose is there. It's been made to suit the people who are not present in this room. Even if you're able to see the presentation, you should be able to get the understanding. That's why you'll find that a little more verbose than accepted is there in that, but you should bear with it. That's what it is. So getting back. And just before we, okay, I'm an author. And this is my book. I'm an expert in container refrigeration. This book has been published in UK and it's been accepted as a standard textbook for container refrigeration in the industry. Okay, just to tell you that. Giant of a ship. These are various particulars, huge in size and all other things. Built in Odense, Denmark. And 2005 built, when it was built in 2005, it was the biggest ship around, and it had lots of stories to tell, lots of lessons to learn from it. The incident. On the evening of the 1st February 2013, container ship MMS, they loaded with about 14,000 containers, was about to pass southbound through the Suez Canal. While in the convoy, a severe ingress of seawater occurred into the shaft tunnel. The flooding continued and extended to the engine room. Within 2 hours, about 14,000 meter cube of seawater had entered the engine room, flooding the engine room up to equivalent to the outside draft of 15.1 meters. The main engine got submerged to the cylinder head level. We generally don't hear of these cases. It's one of the rare cases which occur. So this is what happened. In 1 hour, so much water came into the engine room and then the entire main engine got submerged over the site. This is what happened, level coming up, this is one view, one more view. So entire tunnel, right from here onwards, the water had come and then came into here and this started coming up. And this is the outside draft equivalent of 15.1 meters. This is the bulkhead. This is a bulkhead which was separating the engine room and the tunnel. How the ship was saved? The ship was taken off gunwale and was steered on its own power to the Suez Canal container terminal and finally moored with the help of 5 tugs. During the mooring activity, the ship lost propulsion power and subsequently even the electric power it lost. There was a blackout. Okay, first the main engine stopped working, then there was a blackout. During the mooring operation, the ship suffered minor indentations. The disaster could have been much more severe, but luckily it got saved. Okay, we give certain credit to the crew members as well, but otherwise it was a near miss, you can say, in a major way. Various contributing factors, the technical side, we can say that failure of the forward stern thruster, that's the first thing which failed. Failure of watertight integrity between the engine room and the tunnel, failure of cable penetrations leading from tunnel to the engine room, and improperly designed emergency build suction system. So always you have some backup, You see, it's a proverbial Swiss cheese model, where all the backups were in place, all the safeguards were in place, but all of them had failed, and this happened. So we'll see one by one what they are. Human elements also involved. Failure to isolate the seawater pump from the other cooling water pumps. So that was one of the reasons why they couldn't pump out the bilge water as fast as it was ingressing inside the engine room. Poor maintenance of the emergency bilge suction valve. Emergency bilge suction valve is supposed to be open in case of emergency. They had some difficulty in it. While they were trying to open, the joint, it broke, the handle broke. Person had to go under the bilges and in order to manually use a spanner, and actually he had to open it. That again caused them some time, and it added to the troubles. Details. MMS had two bow thrusters and two stern thrusters, make Rolls-Royce, four-bladed tunnel thruster type operating at so-and-so RPM, each creating thrust of so much, regulated by a hydraulically controlled pitch propeller system, blades made up of nickel, aluminum, bronze. Okay, these are the factors. Each stern thruster is built into 8-meter long transverse from port to starboard. They had a tunnel and it was built in that, 8 meters long, with a diameter of 2.5 meters. And each tunnel had a stainless steel lining where the thruster propeller is rotating. In the tunnel where the thruster is supported underneath by a supporting base plate, you have. The thrusters had run approximately estimated time of 250 to 500 hours and 3000 to 3500 hours since the ship's delivery in 2006. That means it had not run too much of time. So that, you know, you can't say that it's a normal failure over a period of time. It just happened. It just happened prematurely. The failure was premature. So this is how the arrangement was there. So this was the transverse tunnel which was there from port to starboard. This is a propeller shaft. Okay, they're going aft. So this is the transmission joint. So from there you could give the signals and this would be operating the thruster. So this was again the view of the stern thruster supported by the base plate. They had a plate supporting the whole thing. Again, another view of the whole system in place, intact, in good condition. During a border survey and propeller polishing carried out by divers in Rotterdam in August 2012, it was found that one blade of the aft stern thruster had broken off, while the remaining three blades were still intact. That means before the incident occurred, almost 1 year back, August, about 6 months back, so they had a problem wherein one of the blades had got broken. And the other three blades were intact. The cause for this incident was not investigated, that opportunity, and then hence not determined. They just didn't bother to check why it has happened. They didn't go into the root cause analysis, and then they said, okay, let's just get repaired and finish. Apart from this discovery, nothing exceptional has been observed at the stern aft thruster when in operation. The broken blade was replaced by a new one from same manufacturer in October, and no operational problems had been experienced with this thruster since the replacement. That means for almost, let's say, 4 months, things were running okay, without any issue, without any incident, from October 2012 to February 2013. The incidents. The water ingress into the shaft system or tunnel occurred at the flange neck of the forward stern thruster shaft ceiling. The entire flange neck was basically torn off the transverse tunnel at the welded connection. That means the entire thing was there. It just got torn off like that between the flange neck and tunnel and moved forward, creating a gap. When the incident occurred, the stern thrusters were idling, running at normal speed of 257 RPM with zero pitch. The thrusters provide an electrical overload function. There is no record in the event log of the operation of the automatic overload cut out during this incident. There was no, it didn't say that, you know, it got cut out because of overload or something like that. So this is the fracture which has occurred. This thing got opened up and then water entered into space. Inspection. The damaged hatch of the stern thruster was sheared off completely throughout the whole circumference of the welding connection between the horizontal thruster tunnel and the vertical hatch. The thruster, including the loose hatch, was relocated for 30 to 40 millimeters in forward direction and resting on the edge of the hole in the thruster tunnel. Three propeller blades were broken off. Now, this has happened. So the blades have got broken. All these things were subsequent happenings which has happened. Three propeller blades broken off. The supporting base plate was broken. A section broken off from the supporting blades was still bolted to the propeller head. One fracture of the supporting base plate was severely deformed and hammered, and the other fracture was going through one of the bolt holes. 3 bolts for supporting base plate were broken off, 3 bolts missing, 6 bolts and supporting base were loose but still in position. These are all the things which have happened, whole thing. So when the inspection was carried out, this is what happened. 2 bolts of the bevel gear cover at the flange and top were broken off, no damage to the cardan transmission shaft, including bearings and electric motor, feedback arrangement, link was good, but thrust shaft coupling was slightly twisted. Part rupture of welding and rupture of steel plating throughout the damaged area. Burrs from the scoring of the remaining blade tips. Propeller hub, crosshead, crank discs and crank shoes were all in good visual condition. Thruster was completely jammed. The main reason is possible high dynamic loadings and an unfavorable design leading to sharp notch that associated with high local stress curve. There was something wrong with the design that created high dynamic loadings and stress concentrations. Let's see what it is. During the process, changing the manufacturing process from manual grinding to CNC machine grinding and change of drawing from 3D to 3D CAD drawings, a mistake made during the pattern production process led to excessive material removal, a deviation which is not captured by manufacturer's internal quality system. That means it is supposed to have been like this, but somehow this got the shape. There was a change in the radius of transmission between the blade base and the blade. So when the manual drawings were being converted to auto drawings, so this change occurred and nobody bothered to notice it. So that again, that is one of the laps which has occurred during the design process or during the overall process. The weight of the new propeller blade that was mounted on the aft stern thruster in 2012 is 4.5 kgs less than the weight of each of the, there are 4 blades, one of them is a lighter weight of so many kgs. This resulted in an imbalance, creating a centrifugal alternating load on the structure of 4.9 kilonewtons at the operating speed of 257 rpm, corresponding to 3% of the forces from loss of one blade. Imbalance, fatigue. The propeller blades broke off at their bases due to the fatigue failure due to the radius of the transition between the blade base and the blade. So that is one issue. Going on. Failure of watertight integrity between the engine room and the tunnel. Okay, my tunnel has got flooded. Ideally speaking, the tunnel watertight door should have been closed and the water should have been contained in the tunnel, but it didn't happen. Let's see what it is. The bulkhead between the engine room and the shaft tunnel situated at frame number 166 were designed, constructed, approved and relied on as a watertight bulkhead, not to meet the ship's damage stability conditions, but to limit the needed capacity of CO2 fire extinguishing plant. That means if I am able to separate out 2 compartments and make it into a smaller compartment, I can manage with lesser amount of CO2 required for the whole engine room. So that was the thing where the bulkhead was constructed, not for damage stability conditions. There was a watertight sliding door in the port side of the watertight bulkhead between the engine room and the shaft tunnel. This door could be operated locally from both sides, in the engine room, engine control room, as well as the ship control center. You have 2 places for operating the watertight bulkhead door, you're separating the engine room and the tunnel. About the watertight door, there were 2 air ducts, each of 600 millimeters diameter, that went through the bulkhead for ventilation of the shaft tunnel. And then even this have to be closed. For each of these air ducts, there was hydraulically operated valve fitted at the outside of the bulkhead. The valves were remotely operated from the ECR, or engine control room, and ship control center. They could not be operated locally. In the emergency, if I had to close those valves, somebody had to run to the either ECR or the ship's control system in order to close those things. They ideally speaking, they should have been operated. Ideally, the system should have been designed to operate it locally as well. There were 6 cable penetrations in the watertight bulkhead, consisting of 4 for high electrical voltage supply power for the shaft motors and 2 for the other purposes, one of which above and one of which below the watertight door. Some of them above and some of them way below. Cable penetrations. Cable penetrations in the ship's bulkheads, be it be watertight or non-watertight, were GK packing system, which is a modular cable and pipe penetration consisting of a welded frame filling out by modular blocks, some of which have a hole in the cables. For the cables, and some of them are the solid type. There is a wedge sealing block to expand between the other module blocks, making the construction tight and firm. Stay plates are fitted between the layers of the module blocks to ensure that the modular blocks keep their right position in the welded frame. The modular blocks consist of a thermoplastic elastomer, which is flame-proof, self-extinguishing, halogen-free, and UV-resistant. That's how the cable penetration is designed. Looking something similar to this. So this is the welded portion, welded frame, and all these components are coming. You have the modular blocks with hole for the cable, wedge block with ports, bolts, modular blocks without hole for filling out surplus frame, and cables, we are passing through that, and stay plates are also very made up of plastic. Now this design had an inherent fault. Let's see what it is. Training. Training on GK cable penetration system. In 1994, GK packing system was introduced, a standard cable penetration system at the shipyard, to the craftsmen via an installation training course. This training course was not followed up by additional courses, instructions, or certifications to craftsmen or installers of the subcontractor later employed by the company. New employees only received an information pamphlet from the subcontractor with installation instructions in English and German with translation into Danish made by an employee. Without systematic training, the necessary general and skill-based knowledge to carry out effective installation of the cable penetration was obtained by on-the-job training. People relied that, okay, they'll get it by practice, by looking at others. Formal training was not given. With the risk that important elements with regard to correct mounting were not taken into account, it is therefore up to the individual craftsman to determine which components were to be used for each case. So that thing was left at a much lower level. Okay, I'm supposed to, the class is supposed to see it and then say, let's see if it's okay or no. Even that also didn't happen. The mainstay plates mounted in MAERSK were not marked with any maximum pressure. How much pressure, hydraulic pressure you can take, does not marked anywhere. They just put a random. The cable penetration system named GK packing system with stay plates of plastic is designed to withstand fire and gas. According to manufacturer's product information, cable penetration with stay plates of plastic are suitable for a maximum pressure of 1 bar. However, the system was not approved to withstand a static pressure or gas pressure with plastic stay plates. So plastic stay plates, simply they don't take that much of water head. That they didn't realize. Somewhere there was a lapse. According to manufacturer's product recommendations, cable penetration with metal stay plates were tested to water pressure of 5.5 bar and gas pressure 0.3 bar. Plastic stay plates are limited to 1 bar and 0.3 bar. Stay plates of galvanized steel cannot be used in cable penetration for high voltage IC installation because high voltage current will induce overheating. Compared to rigid metal stay plates, the stay plates of plastic offer significant advantage regarding installation weight. They were used in spite of them not being able to withstand the hydraulic pressure. Again, one more lapse. Approval. Okay, class is supposed to approve. The type of approval was system based or not component based. Okay, overall my system is there in place. Okay, I have approved. Again, lapse. Components were not approved. This means that the approval was not based on a specific configuration of the cable penetration system, but depend on the correct installation in any given circumstance. Without any test procedure after the installation, the quality of cable penetration was entirely dependent on knowledge and skill of the individual. There was no method of testing if the cable penetration has been up to the standards. Can it withstand that much hydraulic pressure? When installed, it was difficult to identify any discrepancies from the installation guidance, whereupon the approval process rested. Again, a lapse. So that is about that particular thing. Let's come to the bilge suction system. The valves in the bilge system for the engine room and after shaft tunnel were to be operated manually at each bilge level. Normally it happens that way. When the shaft tunnel was completely flooded and the watertight door was closed, it was not possible to enter the shaft tunnel and close the bilge suction valves. The tunnel has got a bilge suction valve, you couldn't close it. So there was a water pressure, entire hydraulic pressure was acting on it. And then nor could the bilge suction line in the shaft tunnel be isolated, which caused the entire bilge line to be pressurized. The entire bilge suction line got pressurized because of this. And because of that, it was not taking suction from the engine room when the bilge pump was running or emergency bilge pump was running. Lapse, again, design lapse. Operation of the emergency bilge pumping system. Emergency bilge suction pipe had 600 millimeters internal diameter. It was situated just below the pump, about 550 millimeters. That means this was the distance above the tank top and no strainer. The area made up of this elevation, by this elevation 50 millimeters multiplied by pipe circumference, only 1/3 of the internal area of the inlet pipe. Therefore, the flow to the pump was reduced to an unknown proportion of what would be the case with an inlet area under the suction pipe equally as large as the pipe itself. That means if I had put this much space, it would have sufficient, the volume would have been sufficient equal to this particular diameter, whatever it is. Now here, I have made the clearance only this much. So enough water was not flowing through the pipes. It was not being sucked by the pumps. That is one more lapse which occurred. The pump was running in parallel operation with other seawater pump that was serving as a cooling water pump. And the discharge from both the pumps had to pass via the central cooler. Now the newer systems all have a central cooling system. That means the seawater gets cooled by the fresh water. So that had to be bypassed. Unfortunately, it was not bypassed. So the system capacity was significantly lowered. Ideally speaking, this should have been bypassed and given only for this particular application, emergency bilge suction. It was not done. The back pressure from the coolers contributed to a diminished capacity of the pump. One more lapse occurred. Breakdown of emergency bilge suction valve. The emergency bilge suction valve provides direct suction from the engine room tank top. When the engine room gets flooded, when the water level is rising, I start that, I open the valve, and the pump is supposed to take suction. The opening of the suction valve was supposed to be carried out manually by a large hand wheel situated just above the flow plate. The suction valve was situated just above the water tank top, and its spindle was connected by a hand wheel to an extension fitted to the valve spindle by a cardanic connection, the bushing of which was locked to the rod with steel pins. It was like this, and then there was a pin. So I opened this, and this also valve would open. When operating the hand wheel, a steel pin broke, and the hand wheel could not be used. Somebody could use it from the top. That means to open the valve, I need to go somewhere and use a spanner manually and open the valve. The engineer then crawled under the flow plates and used a wrench to open the valve, and while standing on the tank top in water to the knees. There was so much of water was there, he was standing there and trying to open it. So this was the arrangement which is there. This was a cardanic joint. On top of this flow plate, you had the valve, and this was the one which was getting opened up. Now there was a near miss, okay. Something worse could have happened. Let's see what it is. Inability of local closing of the valves of the ventilating ducts. The watertight door was closed locally, but the two hydraulically operated valves in the ventilation duct situated just above the watertight could not be operated locally and to be operated from the ship's control center. That is, somebody, even not for opening and closing those valves, somebody had to go to the ship's control center to close it. However, as an element in the bulkhead's watertight integrity, it's important to be able to close the valves locally. I should have a provision to close these valves. These are important valves. When you are isolating the tunnel from the engine room, you should be able to close it and isolate it totally. Any pipes which are passing through should be able to be isolated. However, the long distance from the watertight door to the deck offices could have complicated rapid and rational actions in the complex circumstances. So luckily, this didn't happen. It was under control, but it could have compounded the situation and more disastrously. And then EMS, inability to of load computer operation at such conditions. During the salvage operation Port Said, it was decided to keep the water in the engine room in order to preserve the machinery components flooded. That means it's not that, you know, you come alongside and you start pumping out the engine room. If you expose these steel components, steel machinery parts to the air, atmospheric air, the corrosion would accelerate. So what they decided, they said, okay, till we are ready from all respects, let's keep it underwater. And then after some time when we are ready, then we start lowering the water. In this special situation, that means for quite some days, it was under seawater. The entire engine room and the machinery, everything was underwater. In this special situation, it was revealed that the ship's load computer could not handle data when the water level in the engine was higher than the sea level. That means the water level was this much, sea level was almost so much. So at that particular sea levels, the load computer, ship's load computer, could not handle the data. It could not give out your results. That's the lapse they found. Luckily, it didn't affect your ships too much. In order to handle this situation in the future, all load computer programs have been modified on board all MAERSK line vessels accordingly. They overcome this problem subsequently. Alarm system, you have alarms. In the engine room, alarms and alarms and alarms keep on coming, especially in such situations. The alarm system, due to the amount of alarms accumulated, resulted in increase of mental and practical workload. When so many alarms are coming from different directions, your thinking becomes, or you won't be able to think clearly. You don't know what to do. And practical workload became a burden to the crew rather than aid. Instead of helping the crew members, it became a burden to them. Problem. Now, God is great. So he looks after people, no? providential support. The events of the accident did not result in more severe consequences due to the behavior of the crew, who managed to adapt to the situation and prioritize the recovery effort to meet the unfolding events. The events of the accident did not result in more severe consequences due to efficiency, effectiveness of the shipboard management. Furthermore, the outcome was favored by the ship's position close to the Suez Canal terminal. Normally, breakdowns occur on board the ships. There is flooding, there is fire, everything happens. It is how swiftly you recover from that, what presence of mind you have, and how you react to bring the thing. That's more important. How much you recover, how much presence of mind you have. That's the one which controls the situation. Luckily, it's happened. Yeah. Okay, fine. I'm coming to right then. No problem. Lessons learned. I'm going to have a summary of the lessons learned based on this. Okay. Number one, for any rotating system, replacing one broken blade is insufficient. The entire set of blades have to be replaced. Lesson number one. Number two, dynamic balancing after replacing components of a rotating system is important. Any basic engineer, marine engineer, would realize that dynamic turbochargers, we have running them at about 10,000 RPM. Gas turbines, several thousands of RPM. Unless you are dynamically balancing them, you are in trouble. Lack of standardization in design and manufacturing techniques among components can lead to undesirable consequences. There has to be standardization. Hydraulic valves are required to be fitted in the ventilation pipes. They should be provided with local operational controls. All the pipelines should be able to isolate. All the valves should be able to operate from locally. Cable penetration, whenever used, should be able to withstand the required hydrostatic pressure equivalent to the outside water level. I should have that. Cable penetration should be able to take that much of 15 meters waterhead. Cable penetration installation is a critical task, and training should be imparted to new employees. Old employees need to be retrained. It's not a simple thing to be left with any junior staff. Somebody has to supervise it. Somebody has to control it. Gap between the class approval process and ship construction process can play a critical role. In this case, this was one of the lessons to be learned. When cable penetration system is approved as a whole, individual components should also be approved separately. It's not that, that the system is okay working. No, I need to inspect the individual component and get them approved. Provision should be made to isolate the tunnel build system from outside the tunnel without having to enter the tunnel. Inlet area and height under the emergency build suction inlet pipe should be designed to allow sufficient water flow in case of emergencies. Otherwise, it becomes ineffective. When using emergency build suction, coolers should be bypassed, should reduce the back pressure. Emergency build suction valve should be operated regularly under controlled conditions, and regular greasing and maintenance to be carried out. Again, that becomes the ship staff's duty to operate it and maintain it on a regular basis. All emergency equipment, unless you maintain it, otherwise it will never work in emergency. So that's the lapse of the ship staff. It is better to keep the machinery submerged in seawater until complete repairs and systems are in place. Exposure to air will, after being in contact with seawater, will accelerate corrosion. It's important for the ship's crew to be adequately trained for such situations where leadership and presence of mind are put to test. These are the lessons learned. All new big size container ships have engine rooms at the midship. If the engine room of the MAERSK had been situated in after the ship, that means the engine room is right in the aft, near the propeller. If the additional weight of 14,000 meter cube of seawater has been added in the aft, the ship would have been light. Then the ship would have developed a trim. It would have come like this, and then here you could have a ship broken into two, because a ship is not designed to be in the air. It has to be in water. The moment it comes, this is always the stress is more on the center point, it could have broken. You could have another such a thing. It's just the providential that, okay, they have put this, and then that's a good practice which we must accept. Final lesson. MAERSK has all the action, drama, and suspense of a Hollywood blockbuster. I wonder why it's not been made into one so far. In spite of the incident occurring, almost 2 years have passed, almost three years have passed. By now, the movie should have come out in place. I look forward to one, ready to work with James Cameron or Tom Hanks or Captain Phillips. Okay, I'm sure in the next couple of years, something is going to be coming like this. So these are my references. I've taken the information from these various sources.